was a poetry open mic host in Chicago for over half a decade, and a place was at Gallery Cabaret in Chicago, and we had podcasts, and people actually downloaded features and things, which was awesome. And so I decided that I would get people that had features, they were invited to pick one piece per feature to be included in this thing, which is so cool. And yes, that was the stage. And that was a painting of the Chicago skyline on that wall. And when you look at it, it's like, man, that looks crappy. But when you see it on video, it's like, that looks awesome. Just see back there, it really did. So I was going to read three poems from this. They are poems about elements in the periodic table.
Oh, yeah.
Because you got to get science-y if you're going to get poetic or something. So I found three odd ones that were in this collection. This first one's called Einsteinium. Einstein understood that everything was relative. Why did he have to worry about brushing his hair or changing out of his pajamas when he was busy grappling with foundations of physics? And once he fathomed the relationship between matter and energy, once he understood the interconnectivity between matter and energy, he suddenly understood that this Jewish physicist left his home in Germany, that Hitler and the Third Reich could be working on an atomic bomb, converting so little matter into so much devastating energy. At this time, he understood the need for Roosevelt to create this weapon so the Germans wouldn't destroy us. The gravity of his discovery in the hands of evil men weighed him down. And even months before he died, Einstein wrote that although the devastation in Hiroshima and Nagasaki seemed unfathomably horrific, and he regretted writing that letter to Roosevelt, his justification was the threat of Germany. Mm-hmm. When he wrote that letter, he still had to appeal to Roosevelt that yes, to save us from Germany, this weapon needed to be created. Knowing about his torment in making this decision to ask for the creation of the atomic bomb makes it so ironically beautiful that after scientists discovered an element after the first explosion of the hydrogen bomb, they named the element Einsteinium after the physicist. How ironically beautiful. Einsteinium is a silvery white radioactive synthetic element with a high fission rate, like the atomic bombs Einstein first knew of when fearing his homeland enemy. But because of the short half-life of all isotopes of Einsteinium, all primordial Einsteinium has decayed by now, and beyond its nuclear creation, there's pretty much ultimately no use for any isotope of Einsteinium outside of basic scientific research. Which makes me think of the life of Albert Einstein, I suppose. For although Einsteinium worked at odd jobs throughout his life until he was a patent examiner, his mind was only good at one thing, doing not-so-basic scientific research, solving scientific fundamental puzzles, if only he had the time to study the puzzle long enough. I know it might have a name, 1-1-7 in the periodic table. Yeah. Well, when this was written, it didn't have a name, so it's Unenseptium, which is all you just think about of the 1-1-7 in Latin terms anyway. And this is 1-1-7 Unenseptium. Oh, and I'm going to have an accent for this. We'll see how long this works. I know you're out there for years, but to get you, after toiling in my Dubna lab, I had to ask the Americans over in Tennessee if they could send us some of their wares. But years passed before I could get 22 milligrams of berkelium so I could work in Moscow or Rusk to get you in my sights. All that time, all I would do is research, hope, I'd work, I'd go, and I'd stand on my own, and I'd live on my own, wondering how long it would take before I'd see what you might be like. You see, I used to work at a pharmacy in Nevsky Prospekt in Leningrad, but that's when I fell in love with learning about chemicals, and that is when I wanted to discover something truly new. And that's when you came into the picture. Because after years of work, I still waited for those damn Americans to come through for us. I mean, we're scientists. We're supposed to be on the same side. So it's all about discovery. And the thing is, the higher we get in our research, the more stable we got on our little island of knowledge. But this waiting was exasperating. It got to the point where I got tired of trying to tell myself I had something to discover, something to share that someone wanted to hear. Eventually, they had to ship what I needed to get you in 5 packages wrapped in lead. It flew back and forth across the Atlantic 5 times and was rejected twice by customs. But once I got what I needed, oh, you were just about the heaviest thing I could imagine. Then again, you'd had me spinning around over the years for you, so it wouldn't surprise me if you'd have the same effect and do the same for me. So I'd work while listening to the radio, and active actions from you would come to me in short bursts. But I'll take whatever I can get in my little corner of the world. This is research. This is what I do, to learn what I can from you. Pull off that accent that long. One last one for you of the Elements poems. I then might end with 3 haikus, maybe, just so it comes quick. This one is tellurium. I can't even remember the number. It's been a while. I don't know the number for tellurium. What? You can look it up. I know Einsteinium is 99 and 1 to 17. I don't know what tellurium is.
I've been remembered in your book.
74. I didn't include it in there because it's, oops. It's not in there, but you can always Google it because I don't have to remember. This is tellurium. When a couple is meant to be together, but at the core they're nothing alike, you can see them come together almost violently before their anger pushes them away from each other, until they do it again and again and again. It's like they can't stop. They can't help it. The rush to each other. They rush to each other in this mad embrace. They feel the intense attraction that they can't escape until they know, despite their lust, that they hate each other so. And they do everything they can to break free. It's a sick cycle they're stuck in, this coming together, this rushing apart. There's electricity in the air. I hear the buzz when I walk past the street corner and see all of the electrical wires crossing in every direction. I can hear the loose electricity jumping into the air. Do you know why electric wires are spaced far apart when they're that high up on poles like that? Well, that's because those tellurium metal alloy wires are so high up in the sky like that because they aren't insulated. And they have a strong magnetic field with all that electricity coursing through them. Mm-hmm. And if the wires were close to each other while they were up in the air, the wires would swing toward each other because of their insanely strong magnetic attraction. And being drawn to each other, an arc may form, causing the wires, between the wires that would be there, destroying them almost instantly. But then again, magnetism in the wire switches polarities at 160 times every second because of electricity's 60 hertz frequency. And that would make those wires want to repel each other as often as they were magnetically drawn to each other. So yes, for that 120 times every second, the wires would vibrate back and forth. So, if there's no electric arc, those tellurium metal alloy wires would vibrate so intensely and violently that if they weren't kept far apart, they would destroy each other, vibrating. Tellurium is used in alloys with steel to make high-strength conductors, abundant cosmically but rare on Earth. It's often found when combined with gold. In the first gold rush, this mix looked like waste. So they used it to fill potholes on sidewalks. Once they realized it was tellurium and gold, Then there was a second gold rush. Acute poisoning with tellurium is rare. Most organisms tolerate tellurium. Organic tellurizer of antioxidant activity in them, and they can even be used to identify pathogens responsible for diphtheria. Its optical refraction makes it perfect for glass. It's been used for colors in color for ceramics, and it gives rubber heat resistance. In copper, iron, lead, or stainless steel, it makes the metals more machinable. Improving solar efficiency cells and electricity power generators, it can actually help also with energy. So, I don't know. Maybe that explains why I've been feeling this electricity in the air. Welcome to the show where there was a, I think that was called monster haiku readings, where people would just randomly come up on stage, and I have Robin Fine and Joffrey and myself reading haikus. There are three different haikus I'll end with. This first one is called Keep. You work harder than men for less pay, so keep up the good work, ladies. One is a found haiku. It was found in History Channel or something. And I believe Joffrey explained, if you don't know what the Ananarba is, for things from World War II, a group of researchers and scientists that the Third Reich and they were using to try to prove the excellency of Aryans and how the German people are awesome. And so they got all these scientists together to help Dr. Evans anything to prove that we're the best. So now that you know this, Himmler wanted the Ananarba to prove Jesus wasn't a Jew.
Oh, wow.
This one is the closest thing to actually sounding like a haiku. This one's called No. No, how does the light feel once you know the truth? Alone in a darkened room. Thank you.